Good evening. Tonight on the agenda, the Shadow Education Secretary Lucy Powell, the comedian and campaigner Eddie Izzard, the entrepreneur Luke Johnson, and the author and columnist Rachel Johnson. It's a modern truth, you can never have too many Johnsons. Plus, it saves on the nameplates. Now, the week has got off to a brisk start. It turns out that quite a lot of world leaders have been avoiding tax with the help of some dodgy firm in Panama. Ha! Who'd have believed it? We'll talk about this brewing international scandal and the very serious crisis affecting our steel industry in just a moment. But first, two authors, Faye Weldon and Ian McEwan, have made headlines this week by stepping into the transgender debate. Ian McEwan kicked off with, "Call me old-fashioned, but I tend to think of people with penises as men," which puts him in roughly the same boat as Germaine Greer, who said last year, "I don't believe a woman is a man without a cock." Thank God this is a late-night programme. Faye Weldon has also been dragged into the row. So let's just start with a few facts. People consider themselves to be transgender because they feel one sex on the inside whilst being another on the outside. It doesn't mean they're gay, it doesn't mean they've had to or necessarily want to have surgery. Some studies suggest as many as 650,000 people in this country consider themselves transgender to some degree. Here's Eddie on the subject in a brief break from one of his 27 marathons.
Yeah, I am a transgender guy, did come out 31 years ago. I've got boy genetics and girl genetics. We get obsessed by it in humanity. We have been obsessed for 5,000-10,000 years of civilization as we gradually become more and more civilized. And a lot of people have said very nasty things to me, have fought me in the streets. Man.
Eddie, talking very passionately about the issue there. Just maybe we could start with terms and explanations. Most people would once have thought of you as a transvestite. I noticed in the last year or so, is that right to say you've...
Well, I was TV when I first came out. If you were watching back then in 1985 when I walked out the door, which no one was, but I was TV. So that was the terminology. And there were TV and TS. And then I thought, why? I go around saying I'm TV and people are saying, "You're a television." "No, I'm TV." "Well, what is that?" "Well, that's transvestite." "So, well, what's that mean?" "Well, that's Latin for cross-dressing." And I thought, "Well, it's not." And they said, "It's about the clothes." I said, "No, it isn't. It's internal." And then I thought, I'm going to grab that whole horrible word, transvestite. I'm going to take that to myself. Like queer was reclaimed, so I'll reclaim that. And then I put action transvestite out there and executive transvestite because, you know, I have all this boy genetics going on and it's girl genetics. And then other people, activists around the world, they said it's transgender or trans. And I realized that transgender is the whole grouping and that I was inside that. And then I said, okay, well, if everyone's using trans, that's fine. I'll go there. I'll say I'm transgender or trans. And then people said, you can't say that now. So I just said, chill out. Chill the fudge cake out. Everyone's just got to calm down on this. We are obsessed about this. When we see a tiger, we just say, look, it's a tiger. We don't go male tiger, female tiger, cats and dogs. We just go cat, nice dog. You can't really tell, but we get obsessed about it. And if you cut off the thing there, I said, what do you add to society? What do you do in the world? That is what should be important. And now transgender has always been the poor relation in the LGBT community. And it's interesting that writers are coming out and bashing us now. So that's an unusual, that's not quite what I thought was be the next move in the world. But I've been out for 31 years. If anyone's got a problem with it, I will fight them.
I haven't got a problem at all.
No, Rachel.
I'm throwing to you.
I think it's really generational, this. And I think that the writers who've come out and said, you know, a man is a male born with a penis, and with Germaine Greer saying you can't call yourself a woman just because you cut off your cock, they've been forged in a time when you were who you were born. And I'm going to make a big reveal now, which is when I'm one of four, and I had three brothers, and I was furious that I was a girl up until about the age of, I promise, about seven, I refused to wear. I was the opposite of you. Right. I would only wear trousers. And if I had to wear a dress, I went into the most terrible tantrum you've ever heard. But I was society. If I had been born, let's say, 5 years ago, I could now elect to choose my gender. And this is what Ian McEwan is talking about. I could actually say to my mother and father, I actually want to be a boy like the others. And I could have continued on that trajectory.
But are you saying you would have done that?
Well, I don't know, because I think it's hard to say, looking back, that if I'd had the choice then, I think I would have considered it because I was so angry about it. I even went to primary school and said I was called Richard. So it went that far, wearing my brother's cast-off bell-bottom cords.
I was just the flip side of you then.
You know, so you were in the dress. Went on and you continued it. We're about the same age.
I couldn't get any access to the dress. My mum died when I was six.
So how come it was possible for you to take your path, which was very, very
brave?
Because
it's genetic. I strongly, I can't prove it's genetic, but could someone please look inside the genes, because you're going to find it all in there coded. I knew since I was four, I've talked to other LGBT people, and the vast majority say it's built in. And it's all a spectrum. It's not necessarily you're this or you're this. And in fact, Ian McEwan and is saying that with a cock, and then Jermaine Greer is saying without a cock. So there's actually a difference in what they're saying. Because she's saying,
it's confusing.
We'll get the operation.
I'm just
saying, don't spend so much time arguing about it. Let's just try and save lives around the world.
Can I just say, what I think is that my last word, because I want the others to talk, is I think that I want people to be happy in who they are. Mm. I also think it's important at this point, when you've got safe spaces and all the rest of it, that people like Ian and Jermaine should be allowed to say what they think as well. So I think I want those two things to coexist in this universe.
Okay. One of the interesting, Lucy, maybe I can bring this over to you. The public, I think it's fair to say, is pretty confused about this issue. There's not very much knowledge out there. If you move from a position of saying, right, this is something that the government needs to do more about, it opens up a whole interesting, because we're not tigers. When we go to a changing room, there's a male changing room and a female changing room. What do you think government should do? Should it be doing more?
Well, yeah, and I think, first of all, I think Eddie is a fantastic role model and helps people who don't know much about these issues to think about them and confront them. And he's had a life of breaking down these barriers, and he should be absolutely applauded for that. And it's the stance that Eddie's taken and others like Caitlyn Jenner and others more recently that have helped us to talk about these issues. I have to disagree with what some of Rachel said there, because I think if you know anybody who is transgender, they've had a life of being marginalised, being ridiculed, being bullied, being discriminated against, and they don't do that out of choice because they feel that they have any choice about it. They don't have any choice about it. It is who they are, it's what they feel. And I think, so, I mean, one of the things I'm very passionate about is that we should be looking more closely at education in schools, and I meet young people who say to me they want more time in the school day, more time on the curriculum when it comes to things like LGBT issues, particularly around bullying, because they feel they are still really big issues in school. So we should be talking about these things. And
so would you like to see specifically education on transgender issues in the school curriculum?
As part of a PSHE curriculum, which could cover everything from sort of sexting and internet safety and radicalisation, but also absolutely about LGBT issues. And as Eddie says, the T in LGBT, trans, is often the poor relation, is probably 30, 40 years behind our understanding of gay rights.
We should say it's about personal and social education, just in case people are confused by the jargon. No, that's okay. Luke, there's an interesting point about this. If you accept that this is an issue that needs to be addressed, then for businesses, for school, I mean, it's almost no end. You know, does every public facility, you've owned a lot of restaurants, does it mean that everyone has got to have a transgender kind of facility, or where do you think it goes? What's your take on it?
I think that's going to be very complicated in a practical sense, isn't it? Old buildings with restricted space, and it's going to be expensive, and someone's going to have to pay for it. It's interesting, actually, in America, New York, restaurants, they only have to have one facility, so they share them, even in quite posh restaurants. And what you find when you get English guests that go to them, particularly women, they don't like using a loo that they think men have messed up in. It's quite funny there. Yeah.
But do you think, at schools and so on, would you like to see more of that? What's your... I mean, this is an issue that has been a lot more in the public debate in recent times.
You know, governors and parents and teachers themselves and head teachers are going to have to make these decisions as to whether, it's a priority in their budgets and whether they think it's essential for the education of the children under their care.
Tom, I feel terrible about having said that gender identity is a matter of personal choice, but because obviously It's not. It's something that you feel very, very strongly that it's unavoidable that you're struggling against.
Absolutely.
But how do we react to the fact that in Manhattan nurseries, for example, children as young as five are being asked which bathroom they want to use? Now, my only point here is that it could lead to a sense of confusion, okay, where none okay, necessarily should be.
There are losers, and they do exist. I'm not sure if exactly what you're saying on this. But the French have some great loos where you go in and it's just what you've got the
generally one might say. Yeah, but well, anyway, yes.
They've also got some of those loos which you just don't have a loo, which I have told the French. Yeah. When I do gigs in French and Tour France, I do complain about that. But they've got these wonderful ones which are more advanced than ours, where you just have cubicles. Everyone has cubicles. Mm. Now we have this thing of numbers of cubicles, but if they're all cubicles, then everyone can just go to the loo, and it is a bodily function. They get obsessed about this thing. People are just going to the loo. Everyone thinks the loos are going to be about something else, but a lot of people just want to go to the loo to go to the loo. Go to the loo, come out and wash your hands and check your makeup or check your hair or whatever.
It's the first time I think we've ever talked about loos in depth on this programme, but it's interesting because of what it reveals.
Hospital wards,
changing rooms, anything like that. Would you like to see... We've just got the SNP up in Scotland pushing through this bill, which, is sort of dealing with it. Would you like to see government do more? And if so, what specifically?
I have not worked out exactly how we deal with this, but if I'm in girl mode, I have girl mode and boy mode. And that's how I've dealt, because I've just had to work out how I can exist. I've tried to carve a space for myself in society, which I think society... I said this to my dad when I came out. I think the British people will be able to swing with this, and generally the British people have. And said, okay, and they're sort of more interested, what do you do in life, rather than getting obsessed again about the sexuality. But if I'm in girl mode, I do go to the women's loos, and if I'm boy mode, I go to the men's loos. And I just do it, and I go to the loo, and I wash my hands, or I do my makeup, and I get out. And that's what loos are there for, and people might have a problem with that, but I'm not going to go get beaten up in the men's loos and do it. I just girl mode and boy mode, and I just do it that way.
Okay. I think just getting back to this point about education, it does remind me a little bit, sorry Rachel, of the sort of debates that we had 20, 30 years ago around if we educate kids about gay and lesbian issues, well, is that going to somehow entice them into becoming gay? That is not what we're talking about.
We need to move on, but just to wind up, do you have a response to Ian McEwan at all? Or do you...
He's wrong.
Okay. Future in politics beckons.
I don't know. I could go on and on about it, but I just think he's wrong. He said it was off the shelf. People are taking things off the shelf. And what it is, if he was transgender, he might look at it differently, but it's a bit weird for him. And because, he's obviously great at what he does, but to just look over there and saying you're pulling things off the shelf. I didn't pull it off the shelf. I knew when I was four, and I came out when I was 23. That was 31 years ago. Surely we've moved on again from that point. But that's so backward-looking. It just seems like the 60s never happened to him.
Mm-hmm. OK, let's move on. It is probably fair to say that the Business Secretary, Sajid Javid, regrets his trip to Sydney. It now looks as if the British steel industry might, more or less, lock, stock and barrel, go to the wall. Just one of those things? Well, isn't the truth that we do still build things, and we probably always will? So do we really want to be reliant on imports from China? And if not, what is the government going to do about it?
The future of the massive Port Talbot steel plant in South Wales and the thousands of people who work there hangs in the balance.
The tension in the town and on the actual plant itself, it's unbelievable. Our lives are on a thread.
These are people that have given their lives to that industry. Are they to be thrown on the scrap heap, or is the British government going to intervene?
Those jobs are vital to workers' families, vital to those communities, and the government will do everything it can.
If a buyer isn't brought forward quickly, well, then we can have short-term nationalisation.
I don't think nationalisation is a solution. I also think it wouldn't be prudent to rule anything out.
People's emotions are, obviously at a point of breaking, and we need to know if we've got a future, where we've got a future.
Lucy, maybe we could start with you. Mm-hmm. Are you in favour of nationalising this company?
I think we have to look at all options, and let's just think about here.
And why you'd happily agree that you would do that if you felt that was the only option left?
Well, I think you've got to look at all the options. And why is that? First of all, because what is happening to British Steel is not just because of market forces and somehow, you know, it's not kept a pace with what's happening around the world. What's happening to British Steel is because of the most anti-competitive practices by China, who are massively subsidising loss-making steel in their own country to put everybody else out of business, and they are succeeding that with that here in Britain. And the second reason that I think we've got to look at all other options is that there's no cost-free option here. If these plants close and the huge job losses that will come with that and the impact that will have on not just those individuals but the supply chain and many other tens of thousands of jobs, if that happens, that will cost the government well in excess of £1.5 billion anyway in paying out dole payments, paying out redundancies and trying to re-skill those workforce. So I would rather, if we were going to have to spend that sort of money, I would rather we spent that money on investing in those jobs, investing in those industries and giving them the sort of short-term fix that they might need in order that they can become profitable again. But we've got to take action against the Chinese dumping.
Just to be clear, you're comfortable with nationalising it. If no viable buyer comes forward in the next few weeks, you're comfortable with nationalising it?
As a short-term option, and we've seen that work successfully in the past, whether it was the rail franchise that was about to go bust on the East Coast Main Line. The government stepped in there, and a few years later it was profitable again. It's now gone off and is in the private sector. Longbridge in Birmingham, people might remember a few years ago that the Jaguar Land Rover plant was on the brink of collapse. Government intervention there worked with the private sector hand in hand. That is now one of our leading companies in this country. So you've got to look at the cost-benefit analysis and leave no stone unturned. I don't think we should jump straight to that as the first option. We've got to explore all options. But for the government to say they will leave no stone unturned, on the one hand, as Sajid just said in that interview, but then rule out one of those options, I think is a mistake.
Luke, you have owned a lot of businesses, you've turned around a lot of businesses. Is this a potential turnaround possibility? What do you make of this?
I think that it's going to be a very tough haul because we have very high energy prices in this country because of green taxes. They have a huge pension deficit that could well get worse. They have very high costs generally, rates and other taxes. Turning around businesses that are global is really difficult. The very fact that buyers aren't queuing up for this, who are already in the industry and know what they're doing, and Tata are in the industry globally as well, suggests to me that the prospects aren't great.
If you were David Cameron, would you step in, or would you just say, regretfully, I need to let this go?
I think it's very difficult because I think you could argue in a purist sense that to subsidise £1 million a day, which is what it's losing, to take on the pension liabilities and others like that, and to become the owner of a private business when the trend, not just in this country but right around the world, has been to divest these sort of private sector assets because governments generally have run them poorly, and those sort of interventions have mostly been a disaster for taxpayers, would be, I suspect, against all his free market instincts and against the tide. However, politically short term, particularly in the view that, you know, there's the EU referendum coming up, he may feel that to see the thing shut down completely would be, politically unfortunate.
You must have looked at this, you know, as I said, you've bought and owned and turned around businesses. Do you see any of it being viable in terms of if, it, you know?
Well, certainly some parts of the steel industry are viable, and the whole steel industry in the UK is unquestionably not going to shut down. But manufacturing of liquid steel, I think, in this country is threatened. The fact is that, it's 15,000 people in Port Talbot, but we have 31.5 million people working in this country. And ultimately, I think we've been successful in recent years because we have adapted and restructured and not tried desperately at all costs to keep alive industries that perhaps aren't the future. And we've become very good at other things, and evolved our economy, and that's what's making us successful. And to cling to old industries where we are not competitive and not efficient and not productive enough and can't compete is not necessarily a good idea, because it's just delaying the pain quite often.
I don't think it's binary.
Yeah. Well, it's unfair competition. We wouldn't allow it in our own country, would we? Someone driving the prices down. We wouldn't allow businesses to do it to other businesses. I believe that is...
They do that all the time. Amazon does it to retailers for a living. Amazon doesn't make any money.
But I thought the idea that if you had newspapers and you started selling your newspapers on the cheap and bringing the prices down,
that was
a legal thing.
You know, this is the world we live in. No, we can pretend away China.
I know. No, but there's not when a government is paying for that. You know, if Rupert Murdoch wants to use his own private money to do that, to put another newspaper out of business, we might disagree with it and might not like it, but that is a free market. But when a government is spending billions of pounds to put other countries' industries out of business that actually are productive and have got a future, that is anti-competitive.
The EU won't allow us to interfere in the way you're suggesting.
No, not at all. That's absolute rubbish.
Are we emotional about steel in a way that we shouldn't be, or should we be?
I think we are emotional. It used to be called British Steel. And I think that there's this sense that we don't want to see the place that gave us Richard Burton and Michael Sheen and Anthony Hopkins and our roads and our rail and everything and our cars and our tins go to the wall. But the fact is that Lucy's right. It's not been a fair market. And you're wrong to say...
Ethically, this is wrong what the Chinese government are doing. And we've got to be trying to work to a world where all 7 billion people in the entire world have a fair chance. And if what the Chinese are doing is wrong, we should fight that. Surely we should fight that. Surely we should give it a chance. What shouldn't happen? We're having a fair chance?
We're not going to get the Chinese to stop dumping and subsidising their steel.
The EU have been trying to put on the tariffs.
But we should try and make it so that we can... Let's just keep their own jobs in...
Eddie, I just want to concentrate on you for one second. Yes, everyone understands. Most people want to save the steelworks. It's enormously expensive. There's the pension fund deficit to consider. It's losing a lot of money. People's restraint about it is about its long-term viability.
I understand. And as Lucy said, you go in short-term and you see what you can do, as we've said on the Eastern Rail Lines.
What are we going to do?
But we're not talking about...
Who in government knows how to run a steelworks?
But who in government knew how to run the Eastern Lines?
No, but we're not talking here about an industry that is in itself not got a future. We're not talking about, say, the newspaper industry that's being put out of business by iPads and downloads. We're talking about a steel industry.
But
we're just
Chinese
about...
Hang on a minute. Aren't shut
we're
their
just,
capacity.
We're just about to build a new high-speed rail link that's going to require steel. We have car manufacturing that requires
less steel.
All huge, massive infrastructure projects going on in this country that require steel. So when our British steel goes out of business, we're going to have to import it. It's madness.
How
it's not an industry
it
that's
when
not
our
got a
energy
future.
Costs are higher than anyone else in the world because colleagues in the Labour government put on green taxes.
The green taxes account for about 2% of the cost of steel. It's a non-argument.
That may well be all the margin they make.
Can I just focus on one thing for a minute, which hasn't been focused on particularly, and you've got Lord West talking about it today, suggesting that the link between steel and defence has not been sufficiently made, and it ought to be, because we don't want to be, in his words, a country that is incapable of making its own warships. And the aircraft carriers that are being built at the moment very largely with British steel. Do you accept, Luke, that that is a link that one ought to at least consider?
Well, for how much longer are we going to build warships? I don't know. I mean, are they going to be relevant in 30 years' time? I'm not sure.
But definitely nuclear subs, aren't
they? Yeah, certainly got a good 30 years at it, because we've just signed a 30-year contract with the BAE systems.
I think there's a strategic and an infrastructural need for us to retain a strong steel-making capacity in this country. I'd also like to see somebody like you come up with a piece that says the cost of shutting it down and putting all the workers on the dole, the cost of running it, we're taking on the pension fund, or the cost of nationalising it. I just want to see those figures put in a row. And I think that Lucy has a point. I mean, running 10,000, 15,000, 40,000, whatever it is. If you look at the associated job losses of people on the welfare, it's a big number.
I just want to, at the end of this discussion, I just want to move in from one subject that's kind of heavily in the news to another one that's been brought into the news today, which is the Panama Papers. It's given a ready-made thriller title. But it's kind of interesting. Eddie, maybe start with you. What do you... you know, you're a man who's not been unsuccessful. You must have had people...
I'm in the top tax bracket, and people, I have heard, you know, with accountants, people did mention, do you want to do offshore tax haven? And it just didn't seem like a good idea. I'm happy to pay taxes. I work my backside off to get to this place, as you are. We're both entrepreneurs. I've done it personally with myself. And when it went up to 50%, because everyone was having a tough time due to the subprime financial crisis that took the whole world down, I was happy to pay 50% because I thought everyone was struggling. And the offshore tax haven, I mean, is it really David Cameron's dad again back in the news?
Well, we don't. To be fair, we've no idea whether he did anything illegal. So we'll have to, you know, we'll have to wait and see where that really goes. But Rachel, what do you think we should make a clearer distinction between avoidance and evasion, because they get quite merged, those two concepts? And do you think we just have to accept that this is a perfectly legal thing in a lot of cases?
I don't think we know yet whether the people who are investing with, I can't remember what it's called, Fonseca in Panama. I mean, I think a company that calls itself an offshore law firm already sounds dodgy. I mean, that doesn't pass the smell test for me. And I think I'm glad Eddie wants to pay his taxes. And actually, George Osborne should really... He always says he's stamping down on this and nothing ever happens. And what we learn is that we live in a world where our rulers are running kleptocracies.
Luke, what do you make of it when you read this? When you wake up and you read this in the morning, what do you make
of it? Well, generally speaking, I think the British are amongst the very most honest taxpayers in the world. We're quite a high tax country. And I think anyone who is... frankly misguided enough to leave their tax affairs to Panama probably got what they deserve.
Lucy, what do you...
Well, look, I mean, nothing sticks in the craw more, does it, than for all of us who pay our taxes and pay them because, not just because we want to, but because we absolutely have to, and we'd be taken to court if we didn't, to see the ruling elites of countries around the world, including our own, the business elites and some of the political elites as well, avoiding paying their taxes. And I think there's nothing that makes us all angrier when we feel that some people get away with not paying any tax when they're absolutely loaded anyway.
Well, speaking of making money, we will be back after a short break to talk about sex and drugs and rock and roll, or rather the Rolling Stones. But then that's the same thing. What happens when the rebels take over the establishment in just a few moments? Welcome back. Mick Jagger once said, first you shock them, then they put you in a museum. If not a museum precisely, then at least an art gallery in the form of a new exhibition here in London on the history of the Rolling Stones. It's a reminder of a few things. They took a lot of drugs, they had a lot of sex, and they are probably the biggest British band in the history of rock music. So can we ever resist a rebel? What does that mean for Jeremy Corbyn, or even the star of the last agenda, Boris Johnson? And is all that rebellion often just a bit of an act?
One can be a rebel and a swot.
This conviction is going to affect you and your music and the Rolling Stones.
I don't know, it might get a song out of it.
I don't really think the establishment as we knew it ever exists anymore.
There isn't a particularly close relationship between the leader and the large number of members of parliament.
Your MPs, will they be allowed to rebel?
I have charity toward all.
We're telling the truth.
Favourite song of all time. It'll be something by the Stones. It'll be embarrassing. It'll probably be You Can't Always Get What You Want.
Well, let's start with the exhibition itself. Rachel, you went round it this morning, as did I. What did you make of it?
I loved it, but I think we have to tell the public that Mick Jagger's a good businessman, and you're going to have to fork out £20 to see their Satanic Majesties. In all their
nothing
splendor.
To the cost of a concert ticket, it must be said.
I did see them live once at Wembley, and I was right up in the front in the mosh pit, and Mick Jagger came on stage, and the crowd surged forward and I was pinned against the stage and I had a panic attack and I left. So that wasn't very rock and roll of me, I must say. It's wonderful. I love seeing their clothes. Have you seen it, Eddie?
I've been running.
You must go.
Running a few miles.
I thought it was great. I loved, there's a wonderful 3D performance scene where you can watch Mick Jagger in concert. I think really recently, and he must weigh about even less than you, Eddie. He must be about 7 stone.
No, he's kept fit all his life.
So by running around, as you were saying, like a cheetah, a young cheetah.
Is that what he says? I don't know.
No, I just, because you were saying that we should run around like wild animals.
Well, we should. We're natural animals. I think I do believe we should be exercised.
Luke, can I bring you in? Rebels or capitalists?
Well, they're clearly capitalists, and I think it's quite interesting, isn't it, that we love the Rolling Stones, but of course they're well known for their interesting approach towards tax, the fact they were tax exiles for a while and so forth. But that's allowed because they're rock and roll.
Yeah, absolutely.
Of course, if they were members of the establishment, they'd be demonised.
You can't still be a rebel if you're Sir Mick Jagger, can you, really? What do you think?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think rock and roll should be left for young people, really.
There's an interesting thing, which is that it feels like, once upon a time, you couldn't be a politician and a rebel. Now it's getting to the stage where, you know, that's what we want in our politicians. Jeremy Corbyn, you know, you've got Donald Trump in America, you might even say Boris is a bit of an outsider. What do you think? Is that a definitive trend that's going to continue?
Well, I have to defend Jeremy's honour in that list, I feel, because
what,
I'm not sure...
you're going to say he's not a rebel?
Well, I'm going to say he's not, you know, he's not Boris and he's not Donald Trump, because, I mean, I think, look, part of the Jeremy Corbyn appeal and the phenomena that he's captured is because he's a man of principle, actually, and he's stood his own ground, he's got his own opinions, and he's not wavered on those. I'm not quite sure you could say that about your brother, Rachel, I'm sorry, he's such a man of principle, and I don't think you could say it about Donald Trump at all. He's just a populist chasing the headlines. So I'm not quite, I think, I know everyone likes to sort of clump them all together, but I think certainly when you become a leader...
Well, as a phenomenon, I suppose, as in that part of their appeal is they're outsiders, they're not establishment, they're not insiders.
I think that their appeal is around, speaking things that perhaps others can't say or won't say.
You're an unequivocal fan of Jeremy, then.
Well, I didn't know Jeremy at all before he became leader. I quite famously had not met him before he became leader. But I've worked very closely with him over the last few months.
He's
a really, really good man. He's a really nice man, and I've worked very closely with him.
Is he a good leader?
Well, that's the question
Is he fit to be Prime Minister?
Well, you know, nothing prepares you more for being Prime Minister than being leader of the opposition.
Has he got any experience of leadership at all in his life?
Well, he's now gaining that experience.
Yeah, it's quite late to be getting it, isn't it?
Okay. Well, let's come to that. Can you be a rebel and experience in life?
Matters just a little. I mean, your brother's had quite a lot of experience.
Okay, I'm going to say something in this because no one's asking me anything.
We're coming to you, Eddie. We're coming to you.
As I'm standing in May 2020 to get election for Member of Parliament, hopefully. I've been a member of the Labour Party. I campaigned in 62 constituencies in the last election and before. So I've been an activist since about 2008. I'm standing for the NEC, Labour NEC, which in the election's coming up.
Do you describe yourself as a rebel at heart?
No, what I describe myself is someone running in the outside lane. I looked at things, like when I came out 31 years ago, I thought this was more honest than lying about my sexuality. To all the haters who are giving hate towards transgender, this is more honest, standing up there and saying, I think this is okay, this is how I feel, it's internally, and I'm just expressing myself and giving myself space. So I will go and do things which are quite difficult. I will run marathons, I'm touring France in French, I'm touring Germany in German, and the Spanish language, and then I'm going to do it in Russian. And these things I'm doing to show that you can be positive. If we have the guts to go for it in Europe, we can be really positive. So I have the guts to go for it, and I will go for it, but I'm not a rebel, I'm a radical moderate. I do radical things with a moderate message.
Okay, you can... But isn't this a great moment for someone like you to become a politician? Because what is clear is that there is a trend towards us liking outsiders. You said the outside lane.
What it is, they want everyone to be individuals, but you also have to work as part of a team, and it's a really tricky thing to do. I think politics is as complicated as it actually looks, and the extremists get this look in because they come and say simplistic politics. We need to simplify politics in the centre, but it is as complicated as it actually looks. But at the extremes, they say a very simplistic view, and people say, well, that's it, we'll just do this one thing. We'll just leave Europe and everything be fine. We just hate the Jewish people and everything be fine. We just do one thing and it'll all be fine, and I disagree with that. I think it's really tricky. You're actually have to try and get a direction through a very complicated situation.
Okay, just
so
to finish,
can I ask Eddie then? Why? What do you think about having a referendum where there's a yes or a no, which is about as binary as you can get?
Well, that's what the referendums are designed for, because people are going backwards and forward and backwards and forwards.
It's so much more complicated.
But my point,
that.
If we're not heading towards a world where all 7 billion people have a fair chance, we won't make it out of this century. I think it's that kind of binary. We have to make an entire world. And if we can't make Europe work, Europe work, then how the hell is the rest of the world?
We talk about Europe a lot, so let's just avoid that for this one joke.
About the stones in this
we're talking about the stones. Well, we're talking about rebels, and I'm interested to know, you know, there's no doubt in my mind that, you know, it is a modern phenomenon that rebels have had greater appeal, or outsiders, you call it whatever you like. Do you think Jeremy Corbyn, who is clearly a rebel, by definition, he's rebelled many times in his parliamentary career, can go all the way to number 10?
Yeah, if he chooses to, if he can make the team work. So it's an interesting time, and I think people want that. They want this a new type of politics where people are being more expressing themselves in a true way. And it's a difficult thing to do, to be a team and be an individual. So he's got his chance now, so he has to go for it.
Okay, well, let's see how it turns out. Let's take a look at the headlines our guests would like to see for the week ahead, or for tomorrow at least. Rachel, you go first.
Okay. The headline here shows Sajiv as Superman flying back from Oz to save, or
Isn't
not, poor Talbot. Does anyone remember everyone saying ta-ta for now? So I thought the Sun headline should have been ta-ta forever when it came to this poor steelworks, which we hope isn't going to be the case. We hope it's not ta-ta at all.
Forever.
Ta-ta forever
Luke.
At all.
This is my headline because Mr. Corbyn is attending Glastonbury Festival on the date of the referendum, probably because he doesn't really believe in the idea of staying in the EU.
Is he playing all his 70s hits?
Attending Glastonbury after the referendum. It does go on all weekend.
Would you like to see him being a little more voluble on the whole question
we'll
of staying in?
I think we'll see that coming, but actually mobilising young people who attend Glastonbury and you know, watch Glastonbury is critical to this.
Then, after the vote might be a bit tricky.
You can do a lot of work ahead of it.
Let's go with your headline.
So poor old Sajid's coming in for a bit of stick tonight. So Minister for Working Dads take things a little too far, because as the business secretary, he's responsible for paternity leave, flexible working, making sure dads get a fair hearing at work. And so just to be a role model for that, he decided to take his daughter with him.
Eddie.
So here's mine. This is linking into recent writers' comments on transgender, I suppose, but LGBT. Writers appoint themselves to head LGBT steering committee, and there's irony in this. And there's people from Victorian Edwardian times back there, backward thinking.
That's something we would certainly be interested to see. That is all we have time for this week. I will be back on News at 10 tomorrow. In the meantime, good night, and thank you very much indeed for watching.